Yes, today we have a special guest, a friend of mine. He's a music insider. He has a lot of insight for us. So it's going to be a very, very interesting, knowledgeable day. You know, so I'm going to, as usual, allow my co-host to bring it in with a few questions.
Peace, love, and lights. I have a few questions for you. Do you mind just telling us a little bit about yourself?
For sure. My name is Dini. Real name, Demetrius Reynolds. I'm from Mississippi. I am a music industry insider as well as executive. Right now, I am on the administrator team for Bizzy, Bone Thugs and Harmony, doing administrative work and overseeing the operations as the vice president.
Oh, that's awesome. What made you want to get into the industry, the music industry?
Well, my path was an artist at first. And being a kid in the from the early 80s, like 83. So when I got into the industry, it was more like the millennium 2000s. And the internet was just getting going. So if you really wanted to learn everything, you either had to know people or be out there doing the work. So I was one of the guys who went out there and did the work until I met Russell Simmons. And he kind of coached me for a year and a half on tour managing. So I did some work in that aspect. Once I came home, I began to think about the business side of things versus being an artist. I kind of did both, but people were pulling me in different directions. Let's just say that when it comes to business. So that ended up taking the forefront of my life and not the music. So I just began to dabble in the music business that way. Came back home, opened up a firm and started managing artists, putting them on tours, movies, soundtracks, you name it. So we began to take off around 2008. And yeah, just been getting bigger ever since.
Don't forget your friend Antonio Blue. You pushed me before too back in the day.
yeah, Mr. Blue. Yeah. I still remember the news appearance you made.
Yeah.
I saw it. I was like, yo, that's one of a kind. You don't really see artists who reach that far when they're trying to reach their community by going on the news.
You don't.
What makes your music different from others?
My music, it's more introspective. It's more of a journal about myself and peeling back layers and understanding where I came from and where I'm going. It's pretty much my music.
Yeah, and I want to get a little bit into a few things to clarify. Yeah, what you just said about the news thing. Yeah, man, I was working hard like a philanthropist for the community, and I had got a referral like I did for everything else, nominated, you know, humanitarian, and then pushed to the news to talk about it, and then that's how I met you, where you pushed me too. But I want to ask you a little bit of how it was working with Russell Simmons. What did you learn?
Man, he runs a pretty tight ship, but super friendly, approachable. Of course, you have to go through your trial by fire at first before you get a sit down. But I just played my part, really, and just learned structure, learned teamwork and what it means to have your basis covered when it comes to foundation before anything else happens. If there is no order, there is chaos. So those are the type of things I learned from Russell.
Right. That's a good game. Good information too. What about Bizzy, bro? You know, working with Bizzy, tell us about how it is working with him, managing him, all that.
Yeah, man. So Bizzy Bone, that was more of a dream come true or a goal. Being a kid in middle school, you know, hearing Bone Thugs and Harmony for the first time, everybody was mesmerized to what they were doing.
Right.
And so was I. I was actually a PK, which is a pastor's kid. So you can imagine that type of music was not allowed in the house. But going to visit my cousins, they kind of like, hey, you know, they sing about God too. Listen. And so I kind of got hooked. Stole a CD from our tape. Yeah, it was a tape. Stole a tape from my cousin, took it back home and just listened to it all night. And just became immensely hooked in the music. Sounded different from anything else I've ever heard. My family's part Jamaican, so their early style had little cadence of Jamaican influence in it. So that was another plus for me. So you can imagine, just, you know, these guys are larger than life to me at this age. I'm in middle school. I make it to high school, and you know, music videos are the big thing at that time. So the music videos were also captivating as well. So I would just, you know, get in the mirror, practice all the moves they were doing. And then I think Bizzy went solo. He wasn't the first to go solo, but he dropped the solo project.
Right. I remember that back when we were younger.
Yeah, 98. It was called.
Yeah. Right.
Yeah. So that album changed my life. I wanted to be a rapper from that point. Just the way that he just articulate and knew his syllables, where to place them, the breath work, everything, you know, that really encompassed being an MC and a fast spitter at that. So I just began to emulate, you know, the way he would pronounce certain words. He was a kid from Cali, but a kid from Cleveland sounding like he was from Cali because of, you know, the regional thing with Eazy-E. So I just began to study all of that and kind of adopted a similar twang in my speech. But this is high school. And so one day I wrote a letter. I said, "Hey, man, Bizzy, your biggest fan out here in Mississippi. One day I'm going to work for you. One day we're going to make music together. We're going to make all this money," you know, like a Stan fan, right? This is probably like 90. No, this is like 2001. Yeah, I think I was graduating like 12th grade. So I wrote the letter then. Nothing else happened. Went on to be a rapper, whatever. I got signed, got my first deal right out of high school. Went on tour, you know, just doing the whole rapper life. 10 years later, when things started to slow down, I had children at this point. So life began to take a different turn because now their dreams had to be my dreams. You know, I had to set my dreams aside because, you know, sometimes the artist grind is a slow, slow grind. So things weren't translating as fast as they were for people like Bizzy Bone when it came to me. So after coming back home from, you know, my training with Russell, I just began to really manifest and really hone in what I wanted to do in life. And I kept seeing, you know, you wrote that letter, you know, faith is good, but if you don't put action behind the faith, what good is just saying affirmations if you don't, you know, put the work in? You know, you can pray and hope, but you got to put work in that too. So I began to change my mindset and begin to go after the things I say. So I just brought myself back to 2001. It's like, just started talking about it, telling my friends, you know, Hey, I'm gonna do this one day. I'm gonna do this. And, I began to work with this crew in Columbus, Ohio, just doing like some little management stuff, administrative stuff, booking tours, you know, getting copyrights, checking royalties, things like that. And my name began to circulate around the camp. And then one day, 2010, Bizzy called me himself and was like, "Hey, I need your help." And we've had a relationship ever since 2010.
I know that feeling, bro. I could actually, like, you know, speak on that because me and you, we built a lot throughout the years and us climbing in the industry. And I have a similar, you know, story where, you know, minister, you know, child, my mother was a minister, father was a Marine, you know, so, you know, and then I had to work hard when they passed away, you know, because nobody was there fighting for me. So it was, you know, this shows people that you need to be there for your children. This is what's going to happen. People going to jump on them, you know, so, you know, I climbed and climbed and climbed. And like you, I'm with my idols, with my, you know, at the time. Now I have new, you know, new aspirations and stuff, you know, but, you know, back then my idols were Fillmore Slim and Virgil and all those guys. And I finally got with them, able to stay in their house and spend the night and, eat and hang out like it's one of my peers, even though it's my elder. So it's
Right.
like it's a dream come true. So I know the feeling. And then going back to your statement about Eazy-E though, how did Eazy-E hear about Bone? Because I know that he personally got up, left Cali, went to Cleveland to go get them. So tell us about that experience, what they told you.
Yeah, so the bone story is one two of how to apply action behind things you say. They just knew for some reason Easy was supposed to be the person to change their lives. And you know, you can wish and hope for things like that, but Bone ended up buying like a one-way bus ticket to Cali to go meet Easy at a concert. So they get out there to Cali. Easy has a concert in Cleveland. So the dudes, they end up calling, you know, calling Ruthless, and they patched them in through Easy. I think Crazy and Bizzy spit on the phone, and Easy like, well, I'm in Cleveland now. If y'all can get here, you guys got a deal. So they went back home to Cleveland, met with Easy, and Easy took them to Cali and changed their lives.
What did they say about like signing to him? Was it, I know it's like the best thing of their life and their dream come true, but did they get specific? Did they give you any inside details on signing at the actual deal?
So they signed a pretty messed up deal. As all the deals in the 80s and 90s were pretty jacked up. So Bone's contract was very jacked up. You can imagine, let's imagine this now. Five kids from the hood, Cleveland, Ohio, right? Bizzy was like 16. You got 17, 18, and 19. Those are the ages. Bizzy was too young to sign, but they signed him anyway. And they gave him less money. They basically signed their masters away, their image, their likeness, everything that's encompassing who they are when it comes to a brand. And you can imagine, all right, you are a grand award-winning, Grammy Award-winning artist, Dove, not a Dove, but Michael Jackson Soul Train Award-winning artist. You broke the Beatles records, but if we checked your bank account, there's probably, you know, no money in there. So that's the type of deal Bone had.
And that's what we're trying to, you know, yeah, that's what I was definitely trying to get at right there, you know, because a lot of the first deals we so desperate and want to get on, you know, that we a lot of us do that on, in the first, you know, in our first deal that's offered to us. But what would you suggest, you know, because I don't really feel like I've avoided a lot of deals. I have offers right now from Def Jam and a lot of New Yorkers right now, the big guys, but it's like for what? They only offering 200,000 and then all that has to be used. They're not telling you towards what they're gonna do for you. So they got shows set up, music they want you to work on. They already got this stuff planned out. So it's like now that I'm independent and I broke through, why would I do something corny like that? You know, like if anything come, you know, join us, you know, because I'm moving forward, you know, distribution, but I ain't doing it. So what would you suggest for people who signing those deals and you know getting offers and stuff?
Well, I've never been, you know, one to quick to judge anyone, but those deals are really based off perspective. And what do you want in life, or what do you want as an artist? If you feel like this selling out, or if you feel like this changing your family tree for a bit, it's really on, it's up to the artist what, you know, how do you want to look at it?
You really gotta you know it's all on you, but it's like you basically gotta stay true. How I feel as a big brother and the father of the culture, the next, you know, is that you have to stay true to your roots too. Not only your own culture, but the world, human roots as well, you know. So you gotta bring other people up, people behind you, help them. Don't be so fast to judge and cross them out, you know. So that's what I'm seeing right now, why a lot of people you know, can't get up, can't get on, you know, because they're not sticking together. They're not pushing each other.
And some people take those deals because they need to change their life, you know. Sometimes in some points it's life or death. And
You're right, but then what if it's like, you know, our grandfather and grandparents taught us, you know, about certain things, you know, and like you go back to the sellout thing or whatever, you know, or you know, it's brothers and sisters out here who got large platforms, but because you know, they're, you know, got melanated complexion, you yourself don't want to participate in helping them come up, even though they're way higher than you. You'd rather go to somebody of another culture and get them rich while you're the guinea pig, just looking like a fool, really. You know, like it all goes back to the plantation. You know, that's how it looks. You know, what's your what's we're gonna be brief on that, but what's your aspect on that? You know, yeah, just you know, if you like, say you have 20,000 subscribers and your platform is growing, and then you're in America, but your Caucasian friend has 20,000. But everybody's gonna go mess with him and grow him and get him rich rather than help you because he feels like you're the same. Why should I, even though he's not really help, you're doing more help for him than you are, than he is for you. How does that really work?
Well, man, in this new music industry, the energies have to match. You know, the days of the one-sidedness is over with. And if people are still doing that one-sidedness energy, stop it. You're killing your energy. Energy is meant to be exchanged in some kind of equal rate, right? Like money. So what I would do, if my friend here is, you know, benefiting from all the work that I'm doing, maybe we're doing the same thing, but he's getting all the opportunities, endorsements. The first thing I do is question what I'm doing. I would question what I'm doing.
Yeah, you got to take self accountability.
Yeah.
You know, that's how I am too. You know, I really take a look at, you know, and that's how it's always been for us. So it's like, you
Right.
know, you just have to, you know, work and figure out a way. But my next question, I guess I got one more question for you before I allow my co-host to ask you a few more is do you think that deal and all that is what broke the group up? And like how did they split the check?
Yep. So, man, that check was split so many ways. It's five of them: the record label, management, promoters, booking agent, warehouses, any type of worker who did the artwork or, you know, anything surrounding the packaging, the pictures, the photography, the makeup, the hair, the performances, the stage crew, the tour buses. So after all that has trickled away, I don't know what they're left with. Them young brothers at that time were still broke.
Okay. Is that what broke them up?
Yes, bad contract. When Bizzy was yelling for his just due, it's like everyone backed away. When he sued Sony for his masters and his rights, everyone backed away. And they blackballed him, so they kind of made it impossible for him to work in the same capacity as Bone Thugs and Harmony. So eventually, they kicked him out.
Okay. All right. Well, good man. Good looking out for that information, man. That was very, very valuable. Kim, what do you have? You got a few more, a couple more questions for our friend here?
Yeah, I just have like two, three more. How did you market your business to like bring in your contact? Like, what did you do to market it?
Which business?
Your music.
All right. I'm more of a person to person guy.
Okay.
I really like to meet people at their level. and understand them and listen to them. Because if you listen long enough, you will hear their problem and maybe have the solution for that problem. So my whole business model has been solution based, to try to fill gaps and voids and address problems before they happen, try to see new opportunities why the curve is happening. Right now we see a lot of opportunities in the augmented world with AR and VR. And there are artists performing there right now. There are artists buying property there. So releasing music in that space with NFTs and on blockchain, that's revolutionary. And those are the type of things that I propose with my business, by introducing these things to artists or businesses, innovative ideas to stay ahead.
Thank you for that. And what are like three tips you can give someone that wants to get into the music industry?
Number one, just start somewhere. You don't have to be perfect when you're doing it. We're all still learning, at different degrees. So wherever you land at in your race, just run it the way you're supposed to run it. When they say be humble, they don't mean being meek and turn the other cheek light. They mean be appreciative and don't step on anyone or don't bite the hand that feeds you. Have some manners and just be respectable. And number three, always put action behind your words. Watch what you're saying to yourself first and foremost. Make sure that you are your biggest cheerleader and that you're not feeding yourself negative thoughts all day long, because we tend to have that habit. But feed yourself positivity and make sure that you're your biggest cheerleader. And yeah, that's pretty much it.
Awesome. Thank you for those answers.
Yes. Yeah, man. One thing I want to say before I let you take the floor, Denny, is that that's how we won and that's how we were able to get here today. Guys like me and you, it took us a while, but we're here. We finally get to see the light, got our head over the water. We were down there. They didn't try to throw us a life raft or anything. They like, man, drown. No, we're going to swim. Yeah. Yes. And we got there, right? But right. We're going to let them know how we got there, because they misled the last generation and said guys like us got there from being aggressive and crazy, which mm-hmm. we have a little bit of that inside, but that's not how we got there. We got there from being meek.
That's right.
I'm like the king of meekness. If whoever knows me, knows I'm very, very meek. I pretty much always avoid conflict at all costs. You know, I do whatever I can not to get into that, because I know what I'm capable of, and you don't want to go downhill. But yeah, now I want you to get into a little bit of your ventures, man, because this new thing that me and you about to do, Kimberly and all my other co-hosts is going to be happy and excited about, including the audience, which is a network called Pod Squad. Tell us a little bit about Pod Squad, bro.
All right, yeah. So Pod Squad is a brand new venture between myself and three other podcasters. My brother being one, being Antonio.
Yeah.
He has a podcast called VOF Sportscast.
Okay.
Sports, I'm the producer on the show. And then we have a friend named DK or Dreadnox. The name of his channel is Dreadnox Gaming Community. And he streams on Twitch live almost every day, killing it. The guy's a comedian, cool guy. And then we have another friend, Pagosi. His channel is Drunk Wizard Gaming. He also does a gaming channel. He's also a comedian, artist, promoter, marketer, expert. And then there's my show, Vigilantes Radio Live, and Skeptics of the Handshake. So we kind of created a Voltron system where we use all the same resources. My show, you've been on my show a mm-hmm. few times.
Yeah.
And when I started that show, it was 9 years ago. I just celebrated 9 years at the beginning of this month. But 9 years ago, for a long time, I had like one listener. and was losing money because of the hosting fees and, you know, things I was paying for to kind of help promote it.
Right.
Plus the time spent, you know, engineering, post-production, pre-production, voiceovers, things like that. So for a long time, just terrible, man. One listener. And for some reason, I kept going. I just kept doing the shows. I just kept showing up. And one day, someone asked me, could they interview me? And I was like, what? Nobody asked. I do the interviewing. And I was like, yeah, I'll do it. So they interviewed me. And during the process, I'm like, I'm kind of thinking backwards, you know, how they approached it, how they took me through the whole booking process, just the flow of the show. And at that time, my show was a talk show. We didn't do interviews. We just did talks. And every now and then I bring a friend on and we'll, you know, talk to the friend or ask the friend questions. And so I was like, what if I pivot to an interview style show? And like this gentleman offered me an opportunity. What if I offer an opportunity to artists? And that's how it started. I was doing, man, 20 interviews a day, just, and they were free at the time. I didn't have a business model at the time. And I was finding myself burnt out, you know, doing free interviews because I would do hours and hours of research. I wrote every episode out to the detail, and we give it to the cast and, you know, let them read it. Sometimes the cast wouldn't show up for the show. Sometimes the cast, you know, would come late or, you know, have an unprofessional setting. It was awful. And, you know, I could understand what could I ask for? I wasn't paying them because I wasn't making any money. Like, what could I do to change the situation? And interviewing just began to make more sense. And I was like, well, what if they paid me to interview them? Because right now it's not making sense. It's not, you know, the hours I'm putting in are not translating to the dollars. You know, my bank account has a negative in it. And I'm podcasting for free. It's not adding up. So I began to just deep dive in that thought and came up with a service-based platform for my show. So I started offering interviews at $5. I even outsourced to this website called Fiverr, and I'll put my service there. Hey, interview with Dini. And I think I was like Houdini Black at the time. I wasn't even using Dini. And yeah, so I still wasn't able to pay the cast. You know, sometimes I would just take turns just giving them money. I give one guy $50 for the month, another guy $50 the next month. And eventually it just ended up being just me. So I was like, okay, I'm making okay. I'm all right. But I'm not making enough money to quit a job or have or even quit a part-time job. So I was like, I wonder how far can I push this? So I began to just play with numbers, and this PR firm ended up contacting me and say, hey, this is what we think your show is worth. You have such and such, how many people in your audience, you're on this station, that station, that station. We think that your show is worth this. And it was more than what I was charging. And I was comfortable with saying, okay, let's start with this number as the base pay for all interviews. And over the years, as my numbers begin to crawl, grow, so that my worth, right? I began to produce a net worth for myself when it came to the podcasting space. And other podcasters were coming to me, hey, how do you grow? Hey, how are you making money? Hey, how do you advertise? Hey, how do you do your show and not have advertisement? You know, so I began to think of a new business model. Okay, what if we don't even think of the business? What if we think of a community? What if we think of having podcasters all be in this community together where we're all using the same resources, all using the same business model when it comes to interviews, if you do an interview style show, all use the same plugs, channels, and kind of create a network, not only a community, but a network, because one podcaster may struggle with their numbers, or they need a bigger show to carry them until they have an audience. And so that's the kind of things that we're working on right now. Well, we already started. We launched in August. We're now on episode 7. We transitioned from an audio only show to a video show now. That includes game shows where we give away prizes, live music reviews, comedy. Oh man, it's an awesome show. It's called The Pod Squad HQ. I invite my celebrity friends on as well to do these game shows with us. So that is the venture that we're working on right now.
That sounds amazing, Dino. You know, we got about 5 minutes. I want to commend you for that, and say, oh yeah, man, you got the music, you got the sports, you got the comedy all in one. Now you got your bro Roski. I'm gonna come with the educational aspect, bring my doctors, my black doctors of herbalists, you know. We're going to spread the knowledge like that, come together as a community. So it's sounding like a great thing you got going on.
That
what you said, is that a part of the development curriculum?
Yes.
Okay.
So yeah, we're podcasters are able to join now. Like I said, we're on episode 7. And we just take a look at where the podcaster is at and where they want to be in 6 months, 3 months, a year, and kind of create a plan to get them there. So it's a fun ride, educational as well. This is stuff that they could even take and teach to other people. So it's like, you know, let's just not even think about selling anything. Let's just think about building first, and then we'll work all the enterprise and corporate stuff out later, if it ever comes to that.
That's great. That's great, bro. We have 3 minutes left. I'm going to let you take it out by telling them a little bit about what it's like getting back into music managing.
Yeah. So there's so many dope artists like Antonio Blue. When I first heard him, I was like, man. Then I had the idea of coming back to manage. I was like, nah, I'm not going to do it. I'm not going to do it. But over the years, so many artists just came through and just dope. And some are lost and don't know, you know, where to go with their career. And I think it's just some instinct as a pastor's kid that just wants to be a shepherd sometimes and, you know, just help, you know. And so that's how I got back in, just wanting to help people.
Okay. And Bizzy Bones, his new album is dropping. Did you hear it yet?
Yeah, man, 1,000 times. We charted. We're number one on iTunes, beating out Megan Thee Stallion, Nav, NF, a bunch of those youngsters. Bizzy is like in his early 50s still charting, which is almost unheard of. So yeah, he put a lot of work in it. We did a lot of work behind the scenes with the campaigns. And this is another aspect that we're teaching the artists, how to really fully be independent. And, you know, when everything is on your shoulders, how to really maneuver in the industry and look your best and sound your best without, you know, without having to take out huge loans or any type of loans. Just really, you know, executing all the resources that there are available, because knowledge is the key to everything.
Yeah. So dababy, a little bit about dababy. He was charting number one. And I heard he was still charting number one on one of the platforms, the listening platforms.
Yeah, the album dropped September the 12th. I think from the 12th all the way to the 18th, he was number one. He may not be number one right now, but I know for a solid week and a half, we held that spot.
Okay.
Yeah, Baby did. He did drop. He dropped, last week?
Them talking about he's blackballed. Do you think that's possible? Him having Bootsy and certain big celebrities who's sticking up for him?
I think he's blackballed out of white of America.
Okay.
But I think the hood has his back. I don't think the females do. I think they're sick of his shenanigans. I won't say shenanigans. I don't know him like that. But I think they view him as aggressive. But then you have some people who like that kind of stuff. So,
right, and that goes back to what I was saying earlier about we don't really need nobody besides our own audience, you know.
Yeah,
so
yeah. And the baby definitely has his own network, and your network is your network. So.
Yeah, but he still need to take some advice and some game from these older, smooth brothers, which he do, you know. Yeah. He does, you know. It's just it gets like that sometimes, a little distracting for a youngster.
Man, you know what? Controversy sells too.
Yeah,
it could all be a big
ploy.
WWE event.
Yeah, it could be a big old.